Professor Rao, ministers, distinguished panelists, ladies and gentlemen. Warm welcome on behalf of the World Economic Forum. My name is Philipp and I have the honor to welcome you. And I'm delighted to announce that this is our first open forum in India ever. So again, a warm welcome. And as you may know, the World Economic Forum is the international organization for public-private cooperation. That means that whenever it comes up any challenge, we are convinced that there is a need for a platform to gather the platform for public and the private sector. And public, that means distinguished ministers, the governments, administrations, and certainly also international organizations. And the private sector means first and foremost business, but also civil society, academics, and the youth. So it's about you. And we do know that the youth is so important, particularly for India. If we have 1.3 billion people, and two-thirds are younger than 35, it's on you to take your own future in your own hands in order to create the future by your own. And that's the idea of today's session. We'd like to bring you together with all the distinguished panelists so that you can raise your ideas about your future towards 2022. What about education, skills, vocational training, but also sports, arts, and culture? That is the idea behind, to have a platform for real interaction with the public, with the private sector, and the next generation, the youth. And on that note, I would like to hand over to His Excellency, our host today, Professor Rao, and it's on you to welcome us on behalf of the host.
Thank you very much. I think we are very happy to have the panel here. And I see two alumni of IIT Delhi here, so that, which is a proud thing. And Minister Irani, I'm not sure why the room is not full. Whenever she comes to IIT, I thought there will be at least 1,000 students. But I think probably this event was not announced for students, or there are some minor exams going on. So this is a very selective kind of an audience. But I think I'm very happy that IIT Delhi is hosting this event. And IIT's, the panel topics, as you can see, are all related to education. And IITs have been transforming themselves. They started as undergraduate institutions. Now we are no longer an undergraduate institution. At IIT Delhi, we have 60% of our students are actually postgraduate students. We have something like 2,500 PhD students on the campus. So we are now a more of a research sort of an institution. But one of the things which we are particularly looking at, which is very relevant for this panel discussion, is, you know, how do we produce more job providers rather than job seekers? I think that is one challenge that we are facing as an academic institution, because the mindset of students is you come to IIT, you get a job. They don't come to IIT to start industries or to do entrepreneurship, though there are exceptions, but that's not really a norm. I think that's what we are actually going through now. We have started many initiatives in the last one and a half years. We started a deferred placement scheme. We said, if students want to start companies, you can take 1 year off and then come back and sit for placements. Even our PhD students, since we are a technology institute, since we want to encourage technology incubation, for PhD students, we are now going to say, after your graduation, you can try for a couple of years in a technology startup. And then if, you know, if it fails, you can come back and continue and sit for the job placements and all that. So we are providing these opportunities for students. We want to see that more and more of our students start companies, provide employment. I think that has to be the job of institutions rather than the government. And I think the policies and everything, you know, they're all quite okay right now. I don't want to say that, you know, something needs to change. I think it's just the mindsets which need to change in the academic institutions, among the students. I think once that happens, IITs will be, you know, a source of inspiration for all entrepreneurs in the country. And IIT Delhi particularly is doing very well. In fact, since two of our alumni are here, out of the 12 billionaires IIT system has produced, six are from IIT Delhi alone. So I think that credit should go to this institute. For some reason, IIT Delhi has done pretty well. So that's the tradition that we want to build on. And welcome all of you to this panel discussion, and welcome to IIT Delhi. Thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much for that, Professor. Thanks, Philipp, and a very warm welcome. Good afternoon, everybody. As a moderator, I could not have asked for a better topic, because I think this is one of the more pressing issues that we are grappling with today, and I could not have asked for a better set of panelists and a more informed audience. Before I start the panel discussion, you know, let me just set the topic and give it a little more context, especially when everybody talks about how India is at a sweet spot, we have a young population, and yes, that is true, because by 2020, India will be the world's youngest country. And we've all often, you know, we've sort of parroted the statistics that two-thirds of India's population is below the age of 35, but take a moment to digest that number, and I urge you to do that, because when we say two-thirds of our population, we're talking about 800 million people. That's roughly twice the size of the population of the United States, more than the population of Europe. And it's particularly striking because population in the rest of the world, especially in the developed world, are aging. So that clearly throws open a lot of opportunities for us. From an economic standpoint, the opportunities are very clear. It means more people are productive, therefore they can join the workforce. More people in the workforce would mean more disposable income, more consumption of goods and services, which is going to give a boost to domestic growth. Some economists even say can boost growth by up to 2%. But more importantly, we need to be a bit cautious. I mean, this is a very simplistic sort of picture I have painted for you. I want to draw the attention of my panelists and the audience this afternoon, because very recently, Harvard University, they came out with a study, and they drew a correlation between a younger population and political violence. In fact, the report goes on to say that youth often plays a prominent role in political violence, and the existence of a youth bulge has been associated with times of political crisis. And the writer concludes, therefore, it's imperative for the government to focus more on education, focus more on healthcare, and ensure that economic growth and the economy continues to grow. Well, I didn't want to bore you with all the statistics, but just to sort of lay out the context for you and the basic themes we'll be talking about today, it's transforming education and employability, enabling innovation and entrepreneurship, and empowering youth through sports, arts, and culture. I'm happy I'm just the moderator and I will not be taking any of the answers or questions to these vexatious issues. So let me open the panel with Mr. Jayant, Sinha, former alumni of IIT Delhi. Must be good to be back, sir.
Very good to be back. Thank you.
All right. Let's talk about, you know, because Prime Minister Modi has painted this, his vision is of creating a new India. And that clearly has resonated with a lot of youngsters around the country. Talk to me about the key achievements of the Prime Minister Modi's government in the last three and a half years and some of the challenges that you foresee going forward.
Thank you very much, Ron. And once again, let me say how happy and glad I am to be back in seminar hall here at IIT Delhi, which, of course, as you know, is where I did my undergraduate engineering degree and graduated in prehistory in 1985. So a very long time ago, but again, very glad to be here and very glad to participate in this panel and to really grapple with a set of very important issues that you're raising. And in fact, these are the issues that we should be discussing. These are the issues that really will drive our future, our standing in the world, and the well-being of our people in the next 10, 20, 30 years, and we should really reflect on those. The good news, I think, is that the reforms that we have undertaken over the last 3 years have positioned us very well to be a successful player in the global economy of the 21st century. And we have undertaken a very deep and broad set of reforms. I have characterized those as reforms 3.0. And I think what we've accomplished in the last three and a half years is actually much more sweeping, much more profound than what was done in the reforms of 1991, reforms 1.0, or the reforms of Atalji's government from 98 to 2004. So reforms 3.0 are preparing us very, very well for the future. And really, I characterize them in three important categories. One, of course, is that we have formalized the economy through GST, demonetization, digital payments, by all of the measures that we've undertaken. We've taken by some estimates, between 20 to 40% of the Indian economy that was in the informal sector and started to bring it into the mainstream, into the formal sector, so they're paying taxes, they can take advantage of digital payments, digital transactions, they can get plugged into the 21st century global economy and so on. So that is a very profound and very important set of changes that we've undertaken. Number two, we focused on being cost competitive. And again, there's a whole host of things there. Obviously, building out a very high-quality, world-class infrastructure, ease of doing business, removing the FDI regulations that were inhibiting investment. So there's a lot we've done to make the economy genuinely cost-competitive going forward. And the third area, which is the most profound, most important area, is that we are positioning India to be an innovation-driven economy. Because we know that economic well-being in the long run for the 20, 30, 40 years of this billion-strong workforce that we're going to have is going to fundamentally be driven by innovation and productivity. And so for us, what we've done through Startup India, Stand Up India, Atal Innovation Mission, the India Aspiration Fund, creating a domestic venture capital industry, these are the drivers. These are the drivers that will really propel our economy forward through innovation and productivity. And I'll close, Ron, by saying the following. I've spent many, many years in America, 22 years in America. And what the American economy has been able to achieve is that it has become the entrepreneurial engine for the top 1 billion people on the planet, you know, the affluent people on this planet. I think what India can become and will become is to be the entrepreneurial engine for the next 6 billion people on the planet, because we are innovating our services, our products, they're being developed for a design point that is uniquely Indian. It's 80% of the features that you get when you buy something in the US, but at 20% of the price. Mm-hmm. 80% of the features, 80% of the functionality for 20% of the price, that's India's design point, that is the affordability revolution, the entrepreneurial revolution that we've embarked on, and I think that's what's going to propel us forward in the future, and that's what we as a government have been focused on.
Thanks, Mr. Sinha, for laying out the overarching vision of the government. Ma'am, if I could come to you now, because you know you were the HRD minister, and you've seen, you know, you've sort of seen the evolution of the Indian education sector from very close quarters. And one concern that has often come up is about the quality of students, especially at the primary level. And and perhaps many would agree with me in this room that there was a feeling that, you know, when India gained independence, most of the other East Asian economies invested a lot in education. Somehow, India did not. I think per year, I think I was reading Utkarsh's article, less than $2 million, Utkarsh. Yeah. Isn't that right?
First 5 years.
So do you think in hindsight that was a mistake for which we are still paying? And how do we overcome this historical legacy that this government has inherited?
I think in hindsight, everything is 2020. So to say that everything went wrong, and to say that we are burdened with past legacies would be an understatement. Money is not the problem. In my 2.5 years in the education system, money was never the problem. I think, as Dr. Rao has said in his opening remarks, the problem is also about mindset. In your opening remarks yourself, you brought everybody to notice that when we talk about 2/3 of the population, the number is enormous. It's 800 million people. Now, how do you use that amount of energy in your country to help them become a part of the solution? In this very hall, close to 2 years ago, we started something called the Unnat Bharat Abhiyan. And we had told every higher educational institution, and in fact, IIT Delhi is now where it is instituted, now where the fulcrum of the whole activity is. We said that instead of us going and asking people to help solve grassroots challenges, can institutions like IITs or colleges or universities look at only 5 villages around your institution, take the technology that you are developing or you have access to and apply it only to those 5 villages and see how many people get help. I was recently told by Dr. Rao that that number of villages that now interact in terms of technology and giving them inputs in terms of education has risen to 1,000. Now imagine, this is just around 100 institutes which are now working with 1,000 villages. Imagine if many of us start taking that route of engaging with people using technology as an enabler and making sure that there are resources that they can connect to directly. For instance, when I was in HRD, we said that today one of the biggest challenges for children is access to resource materials, like books or additional material that they'd like to possibly read. We digitized every book in the school system available to us. We also recognize that when you talk about medium of instruction, people say, especially in the rural area, that I might have books written in English, but I do not speak that language. How do I get access to that knowledge? We started a portal which converted every available English book that is fed into the system into a local dialect in 22 scheduled languages. The issue is now that those structures have been created, how are we linking more and more people to those structures? And I think that is where the solution lies, because the Prime Minister, as he has said often, is that to presume that the government only can make things work means that we believe that democracy fundamentally means I've chosen somebody for 5 years, they'll give us the solution, and we'll see what happens after 5 years. What is significant about these 3 years is that for the first time, we are having conversations on details of what makes the economy tick, details of how we can make our education system better. So we have moved from this paralysis in our democracy, where people just looked at a political establishment and said, well, nothing is working, we'll look at it and revisit our views 5 years down the line. Now, with even engagements like MyGov, people are coming forth and saying, I have a view on a policy decision that you're about to make, and if you take my view into consideration, maybe your path will change. And I think that interaction is something which is very different about this particular government. And that interaction is not limited to education, it goes beyond and actually touches almost every segment of governance. So education is just one part. For instance, we talk about innovation, and Jayant is absolutely right when he says that when people look at India, they look at affordable innovation. When I talk to children, let's say in the 12th standard, or those who have gotten into the undergrad program, most of them said, well, if I just had somebody encourage me when I was in the 6th standard, possibly I could have been more inclined towards science. Because when you look at the measurement of how aptitude-wise a child fares, you will see that in science and mathematics, it's declining. So how do you arrest that decline? Niti Aayog started something called the Tinkering Labs, and Atal Innovation Mission is now looking at upgrading labs only from the 6th standard to the 12th standard. Similarly, I saw that most of the time when we looked at entrance into the IIT system, 90% to 95% of them were men. And I said, what happens to the female population? And we were told, well, in the 12th standard or the 11th standard, people felt that it's nice to give these extra support to a male child in the family because the daughter has to get married and leave. So if we have to send them for, let's say, some coaching, why spend on the girl? We'll spend on the boy. And that is why men and more women were falling out, so much so that when I went to the Bhabha Atomic Research Center, I found 75% of the administrative staff was women, but the scientific staff had only 25% of women in it. And when we spoke to female scientists, they said, well, if just somebody reaches out to these girls, possibly we can, you know, see some kind of an increase in the number of girls who participate in institutes like IIT. So we started something called Udaan, very small. We said those girls with the aptitude for science in 11th and 12th, we will give you additional devices where you can study, a 24/7 helpline. We had IIT professors, school principals who said, well, I will take the responsibility of one child. I'm a phone call away from that child. And every weekend when the child would sit for some kind of a exam or a competency test with these professors, whatever marks they would get, we would end up paying that amount as fee for the child when she would enter into the system of any science and technology institution. And we've met with 80% success in it. So these are the baby steps that we've taken, and this is not a step taken only by the government. We've had professors stand up and say, we'll help. And I feel that that is the way forward, a synergy between government and people, because ultimately what we are trying to fix is ours. Our own country.
You know, you gave the example, ma'am, of the initiative of the portal, the mygov.in, and that kind of preempted my question. So I want to throw one more question to you and Minister Jayant Sinha before I throw it open to my panelists. Tell me, you know, I'm rather curious to know, because, you know, we have a young population, aspirational, information barriers are breaking down. What sort of pressure does it put on
ministers and politicians. What sort of an impact does this have on governance? Ma'am, if you could start, and then I'll ask Mr. Sinha to comment.
I think that one of the best impacts I have seen is the response time by the government. Let's say even in an establishment like the IIT Delhi, when I walked in and I met Dr. Rao, the first question I asked was, did the hostel food get better? Mm-hmm. Because the last time I had a student when I was in HRD who tweeted to me that, ma'am, next time you come to IIT Delhi, can you just pop into our hostel facilities? And I did. And Dr. Rao was kind enough, that was one of his first few days in the organization. He went around and now he tells me that I sit there once a week, I eat with the students. Mm-hmm. I think that when a citizen reaches out to you and then you respond, not only as a government, but also institutions which are not government per se, but at least in some way or the other associated with government, I think that helps bring solutions faster. In terms of the pressure on a politician, I think it's good pressure because mm-hmm. democracy needs that pressure. Mm-hmm. And the fact that our Prime Minister was courageous enough to say, well, we want our system to be under that pressure, speaks a lot for his own ability not only to lead, but also his desire to provide timely solutions to citizens.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Sinha?
Yes, Smriti ji is exactly right. I think that kind of interaction and the way in which that is enabled through technology, through social media, creates tremendous positive pressure. And of course, in my life, either when it comes to aviation, where we've launched Air Seva and received thousands of complaints, 93-94% of which we have resolved, or whether I speak as a Lok Sabha member and people are tweeting me about potholes or they're tweeting me about schools that don't have teachers, any of those kinds of complaints we can now address in a much more responsive way, in a much quicker way. In fact, I've been able to get both my DCs in Hazaribagh district and Ramgarh district to also be on Twitter and Facebook, and they're constantly replying to people and dealing with issues as they come up. So technology, social media, all of these make government much more responsive, much more able to deal with what needs to happen in real time and in a very efficient manner. So I think that's fantastic. And in general, for us really, again, coming back to how we should be thinking about the future and what are the great enablers, technology is really the key to all of this, because that's what enables you to do things in a non-linear, exponentially improving manner. And we have to be prepared to leverage and utilize technology in every facet of what we're doing, because that's where the innovation is going to come from. So with respect to citizen interaction, fantastic, but we have to really make sure that it is pervasive in the way in which we run the government, in the way in which we conduct ourselves as citizens. Mm-hmm.
So far, we've talked about the role of the government and what the government is doing in sort of putting the systems and structures in place. Mr. Bhartia, what is the role of the private sector?
Firstly, thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Nice to be here in IIT Delhi. I passed out in 79, much before Jayant. That time we were using slide rules, And in 78, 79, we just saw the first Texas Instrument scientific calculator.
Hari, I learned my programming on punch cards right here on ICL 2960. Yeah. That's how old we are.
So how technology changed in 1 year, my life, in terms of slide rule to getting on the calculator. Ron, I want to raise one important issue, and which I deal with, and since the subject is about skills, and I want to raise this because of my own experience. 65% of India is dependent on agriculture. And the economy of agriculture is only about 14%. Mm-hmm. So it's highly inefficient. As we know, the productivity is very low. We cannot have so many people employed in agriculture. Mm-hmm. So what we are seeing is a big thrust as industry or as businesses, is large number of people who are coming from the rural areas seeking employment. And the challenge that I see, while we talk about technology and reskilling of people who are already skilled, but my major issue is a lot of people are first-time job seekers. Mm-hmm. Their parents are laborers or farmers. They have no mentoring at home. All of us here, we are sitting in this big institution, all of us here had great mentors as our parents, mm-hmm. because they told us where to study, how to network, how to get admission, where to do coaching, and where to get a job. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And once you get your first job, you are into the system.
Yeah.
Then you can. Yeah. And if you've passed out of IIT, you don't need any reskilling. If you need reskilling, it's your problem. You go and find what to do, and you'll be fine. But the person whose parent is a laborer, he doesn't have any mentor, really. He doesn't have even soft skills. You know, we go into villages to tell people how to run a food outlet. Very simple. Now, they don't have habit of coming on time. They don't know how to dress properly. They don't know how to speak. And so even the soft skills are missing because there is no mentoring. And I see that as the biggest challenge, that how do you get the person the first job? Mm-hmm. And the interesting part is, if he gets the first job, you know, we hire 25,000 people every year. Mm-hmm. They last only with us for 1 year, because after they work for a year, they find much better jobs. Then they are networked.
Right.
And then they are able to skill themselves, they are able to think themselves, because they have got some basic level of life training. Mm-hmm. Now the key thing, in my view, the biggest problem that the government needs to face is how to give the job to the first-time job seeker, whose parents are not real job holders, because very few people have organized jobs, you know. Mm-hmm. Percentage of jobs in India is very small. Most of them work as part-time laborers or part-time farmers or part-time service providers. Now, if their kids have to come into the job market, and I think all that cannot be done through or skilling programs. Mm-hmm. In my view, entrepreneurs who are giving them the first job should be the one rewarded. That, look, you are giving this person who's class 10 pass, because I'm not worried about the graduates. Yeah, mm-hmm. There are issues there. You know, they need to be skilled and better skilled and all that. But somebody who has dropped out of school and needs a job. And that's the largest number that we are dealing with. We are talking about technology and everything. But technology, again, on the side, technology is also a challenge, because technology is reducing jobs. And I can give you examples of it.
Yeah.
That where technology is also compressing jobs. Mm-hmm. So we are facing double challenges today. You know, today, just to give you an example, we have 1,100 pizza outlets. Now all the orders come online. So when orders come online, two order takers per store is gone. Mm-hmm. So you have 2,200 jobs are reduced because technology is now taking that over. Mm-hmm. So we are facing double challenges, right, here. So my experience has been that in India, because of the such large rural population who will need jobs, mm-hmm, is where a large amount of focus is required. And I don't think that you can bring them to a higher level of class 12 education. You have to give them jobs wherever they are. If they're class 10 pass, we have to give them jobs. If they're class 8 pass, we have to give them jobs. And this cannot be done through skilling institutions.
Yeah.
It has to be done by businesses directly. We'll train them and we'll give them jobs.
Absolutely. Ma'am, you want to come in?
Partly to support what Mr. Bhartia is saying. His observation, I think, Hariji, about industry being rewarded because they help mentor and put them in a very structured formal economy and pathways, correct? Because in textiles, we have seen that whatever skilling happens in conjunction with industry, we have had a success of 72% in terms of placement. And when I say 72% success in terms of placement, I mean that we call up that individual even after 6 months of being in the job just to check whether they retain that job. Rightly said that once you're given everything in terms of support, after that, if you do not manage to keep your skill sets prudent enough or important enough for your organization, then that is an individual issue. Mm-hmm. But to support what he has said, I have personally seen a 72% success rate wherever the skilling is done in conjunction with the industry, because mostly one skill the individual, the industry itself absorbs, given that they for themselves see how well the upskilling or the intervention has helped. But Textiles is another industry where you see that technology threat in terms of disruption is very mm-hmm. severe. And I have seen that, let's say, a weaver, mm-hmm. Their children do not want to weave because they feel that I don't want to, you know, be looked upon as somebody who is a part of a very... drudgery should not come as an adjective the minute somebody sees me. Mm-hmm. So wherever to a weaver's family, especially the youngsters, we have told them that if you want to do designing of a particular old legacy piece, why don't you do it on a computer? Those are the kids mm-hmm. and those are the families that retain the art. Mm-hmm. But wherever the kids say, we do not want to be a part of this and we want to move over and find another job, that is where the challenge comes. So technology, while there is fear-mongering, that will be a huge disruptor, at the same time, it has enabled in preserving legacy works in many an areas. Mm-hmm.
In fact, I will be touching about technology and its impact on jobs a little more deeply. But Utkarsh, you've been doing a lot of interesting work on the field of education, trying to change the mindset, how we think of education. And you've also partnered with the Atal Innovation Mission. In brief, tell us about a little bit more about the experiences you've had.
Sure. I think if you go and analyze just to 3 or 4 years ago, how did board examinations in India were conducted? So one question that struck me was, what is the speed of light till 8 significant figures? A similar question asked in the UK was, why is the speed of light measured till 8 significant figures? Now, this focus of what to how and why is where India needs to go. And I feel Atal Innovation Mission is a step in the right direction. And now I'd like to draw upon the points made by a panelist on the importance of mentoring. Many times, you want people to be able to combine their skills and figure out economic opportunities and educational opportunities, leveraging their strengths. Mm-hmm. Not necessarily because this is something that you should study. So one of the most interesting innovators globally are the people who are contradisciplinary, people who are physicists and poets, mathematicians and musicians. So my vision for this...
A physicist about poetry.
Yeah. Okay. If Adam Grant, in his book Original, talks about contradisciplinary people have it. If you look at Nobel laureates and contradisciplinary people, there's almost a 22x improvement if you look at the Nobel laureates and what they study. Math, music, poetry, physics. Because you're able to draw upon subjects. So the focus from rote learning and focusing on what, through the Atal Innovation Mission and other programs that are being championed, is moving towards why and how. Recently we had teachers from 25 schools, a part of the Atal Innovation Mission, come and learn about what are some of the best practices in the technology space mm-hmm. that are happening they can include in the classrooms. They had amazing insights on the ground. And once they were trained on technology, once they knew that they had support from Mentor India, which is corporate world, people from startups coming and mentoring mm-hmm. in classrooms, the whole new set of possibilities were unleashed. And now, if you look at the World Economic Forum's competitiveness report, it ranks India at 40. If you go down further, in terms of innovation, we are 29th. In terms of education and health, we are 91st. Mm-hmm. And if you look at innovation, it's more focused on Bangalore, Delhi, Bombay. You can't have a localized innovation. So I'm here to make a case for a more inclusive innovation, where there is a Bangalore and Bhagalpur, where there's a Hyderabad and Harisal, India's first smart village. And that can only happen if you shift the focus from what to how and why. And I think Atal Innovation Mission and some of the other programs are pushing us in the right direction.
In fact, talking about the World Economic Forum competitiveness report, I think India jumped 16 positions also, I think a year or so ago. And therefore, to manage that 40th position perhaps is not bad at all. Anu, you're in a high-skill industry, map my genome. What has been your experience like?
So I think, you know, when you think about the future and you say that, you know, we can do things the way we currently do, I think that's first a flawed assumption, because I think we are going to be living in a world where robots are going to be more omnipresent. We are going to be living in a world where CRISPR will become real. We are going to be living in a world where sequencing will become cheaper than anything else. So I think one thing that is common, and I think Utkarsh brought that up also, was that the lowest common denominator for all of that is the freedom of thought, mm-hmm. right? And how do we develop a skill set in a country where we can actually get people to start thinking? And I think that is one big thing. Because when we started, Osimum 17 years ago and MapMyGenome 5 years ago, which were newer areas for the country at that time, I think one of the biggest challenges we had was to find people who could start thinking in a completely different subject, right? Mm-hmm. So we are trying to say that you want to do bioinformatics, you want to do genomics. How do you get people who were trained in biology and in mathematics and something else? Because you now have to think beyond what you were taught, whether it was in school, whether it was in college. So I, at least my thought process goes that what we had to do was we got people together with different skill sets, but we looked for aptitude in terms of aptitude and attitude in terms of how they're going to solve problems. And I think that would be a biggest thing that we need to focus on, because in the end, I think we can make smaller changes by looking at what we can do in the next 3-4 years. But if we want to solve the problem of our youth, that is going to be, you said the young youth dividend, the problem is that we will also be living longer because, we would have solved a little bit of the aging nirvana problem. Mm-hmm. We would have also solved a lot of other things from a scientific perspective. So how will this youth be able to solve those problems if we cannot instill in them a way of how to think?
Right.
And what if?
Yeah. Right? So let me add to that, and let me start that with a personal anecdote. When I was running for elections in 2014, there was a newspaper article which said about me, from Harvard to Hazaribagh. Okay, they said from Harvard to Hazaribagh because I'd done my graduate work there. But they've got it exactly wrong. Actually, the story of my life is from Hazaribagh to Harvard. And I think that is precisely the way we have to think, because if we start with this elite mindset mm-hmm. that we have to go top down, that the smart people, the wonky heads at IIT Delhi or Harvard or Yale or IIT Bombay or wherever are going to be able to go to Hazaribagh and get them to undergo a cognitive revolution, friends, that's not going to happen. We have to think the other way around. We have to say from Hazaribagh to Harvard, how are people going to travel that journey? And how are we going to be able to go to the Tati Jharias and the Dadi blocks and the Rai Barelis and the Amethis where Smriti ji has spent a lot of time? How do we go to those parts of India and enable them to undertake those personal journeys where in effect cognitively they can develop, they can get to the point where they can do this advanced, sophisticated kind of problem solving that you're all talking about? But we have to start at the grassroots. We have to start there. We have to start in Hazaribagh. We have to start in Amethi. And then we have to equip them at scale with the tools, the technologies, the skills so that they can progress themselves. That is, I think, a central challenge, a central task before us. If indeed we have to equip our people with the soft skills, which Hari is exactly right, we need to be able to equip them with. But we have to start there. We can't start top down. Right. We've got to start grassroots. And again, I think, as I was saying earlier, technology is really the only way to be able to do that.
So we need to eschew the top down approach. Ma'am, you want to make a comment?
I think just to complement what Jayant is saying, my own 2 years in HRD, there was one fascinating report which came in. And Jayant is absolutely right. We have this thing that hum sheher se jayenge and we'll teach people in the village what to do. Fascinatingly, there was analysis done by NCERT in the National Assessment Survey, and it was found that children in the district of Ratnagiri had a better aptitude for mathematics and a better performance in mathematics as compared to children from Mumbai. Which just threw a lot of academicians, they said, what? Aren't the Mumbai kids supposed to be and the Delhi kids supposed to be smarter? So the only challenge which happened to these children who were doing so well in mathematics and science in the school level is that to come to a higher educational institution which is extremely charismatic in a city like Mumbai and Delhi, they needed better resources. They needed, in terms of aptitude and language, they needed that mentoring as Hariji is saying. And imagine if that is provided, if that bridge is built, they are happier doing their little labs and their little tinkering items in their own village, in their own districts. It's just that they need to go to a situation where they can get those skills, technology and other skills, and just come back. They're happy to be back. It's just that the discontent arises when they do not get that support in their own districts, and when we are putting too much pressure in only a few centers in our country, and that one academician then has to cater to 50 or 100 or 200 students, and even that one academician then says, this is too many for me to mentor. So to taper it all out, we have to kind of, you know, make sure that this particular effort, as Hariji has said and Jayant supplemented, is taken to the villages, to the districts, because they are performing very well academically. We only lose them out of the after the 12th standard. And again, to reflect on what Hariji has said, for the first time in the history of our country, this government, when you talk about getting people into formal jobs, walk in, ask any middle class, lower middle class Indian. The first question they're asked when they walk into a job is, "Kahan pade ho? Show me the certificate." And if they have been in the informal sector using only their skills and working, let's say, and studying in an ITI, they never had a certificate to show. So for the first time, this government said that if you have gotten some skills through an ITI, which is in the rural level, and you sit for this exam, competency exam, you will get your 10th standard certification from that ITI. You do not have to go and get enrolled. We'll take into cognizance the amount of years you've spent in the informal sector working. So that arrangement, that bridge, has been given for the first time in the history of our country. Mm-hmm. The only thing is how many people know about it and how many people now use that facility to take themselves forward.
Absolutely. Some great points have been made in the first 15, 20 minutes of the discussion. And I want to, we did this a Twitter poll, World Economic Forum did it, and there were two rather simple questions. And I want my panelists to sort of ponder a little over the answers and the results we've got. So the first question was rather a straightforward one. Are you optimistic about India's future? And 17,000 votes were cast. An overwhelming 80% have said they're very optimistic about India's future. 9% minority, they say they are not. 11% say it's complicated. Well, it's complicated according to 11%. The other question. What's the biggest challenge for India's leaders in the next 5 years? This is interesting. About 3,000 people cast their votes for this one, and the response and the final answers and the results show that 37% feel inequality is the biggest challenge. Another 37% feel corruption is the biggest challenge. 19% feel it's the environment that poses a threat and the leaders should be should take cognizance of, and 7% believe it's digitization. Interestingly, Mr. Bhartia, if you could perhaps ponder over this inequality, 37%, are you surprised? Or perhaps, you know, that's also been one of the themes that, you know, how we need to sort of have different pockets of excellence of education.
Actually, because, you know, if we don't deal with inequality, especially when the largest mass of population is in the rural areas, because the kind of, you know, urbanization has its own advantages, as you know.
Yeah.
It builds network, it builds ecosystems, and even for innovation or networking or even finding jobs. Huh? And that's why sometimes you find there are hubs which happen in the urban environment, because whether it's a Tirupur, you know, in textile, because people learn from each other, because there is a concentration of people in that. Now, the rural area does not have that advantage, but the largest number of population live in that part. And they feel that they don't have access to that network. Mm-hmm. And when I say network, means it's a lot of things. Mm-hmm. It's a mentoring support system. Sometimes you don't have your own mentors at home, but if you are in an urban area, you are in a concentrated area, you get networked, you know, mm-hmm. with friends, people around it. And you see other people doing a job, you learn the same skill and you get into that network. So inequality, yes, people feel that, look, these guys are rich, they are becoming richer, and our state remains the same or becoming worse. And in my view, in some cases, it is becoming worse. The reality is there. So, and this problem is not only in India now, it's in US we are facing. Yeah. US,
we are all
US
living in the post-Piketty world, so to speak.
So US is seeing that, because there's a huge inequality that is starting to happen, because some people have so much advantage in terms of, you know, it could be technology, it could be access to capital. Mm-hmm. So I think I'm not surprised. Mm-hmm. I'm not surprised. And it is true. It is true.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Sinha, you want to take this question about the fact that, you know, the government has played a huge role in slaying the corruption beast over the last three and a half years. But somewhere, you know, that concern, the fears still continues to linger in the minds of the people, as the poll suggests.
Yeah, you know, I think the term inequality in this particular case probably hides many other meanings. And really, I think what it is picking up, as Hari is saying, is this whole idea of haves and have-nots. Of course, as far as the organized sector is concerned and people with stable employment are concerned in India, that's a very small number of people. Everybody in this audience probably has expectations or already got stable employment, so we don't worry about that. But I would say that the vast majority, 90% plus of Indians, is much more concerned about stable employment and being a have-not. And I think that's the whole inequality concern that people have. And again, as we were discussing earlier, we really do have to think very carefully about how is it that we are going to get people out of the anxiety and the stress associated with being a have-not and bringing them into secure, stable employment. Looking at the world around us, looking at the nature of jobs in the future, the nature of organized employment in the future, we may very well have a future where there is, in fact, going to be a very small number of people that have, quote-unquote, secure, stable employment. The vast majority of us will be in employment of various kinds. It may be that, you know, you are a driver at Ola, or you're an Amazon delivery person, or you're an individual entrepreneur and you're running a beauty parlor. And that's going to be the vast majority of people in work. When that happens, if that is in fact the future, what does that mean for people's aspirations and expectations? Because coming back to this question of what is it that people want in rural areas, do they want to work in a fast food restaurant? Or if you ask them, what is the concept of a job? All of them will tell you, I want to sit in an office, and I want to have a desk, and I want to have an air-conditioned chamber, and maybe a computer. That is their concept of a job. Now, what is the actual concept of a job which we'll be able to deliver to them in the next 20 or 25 years? That is the anxiety, that is the existentialist angst that we are seeing in all societies right now, not just in Indian society, because we really don't understand, with respect to the way in which the global economy is evolving, what is going to be the nature of jobs, what is going to be the nature of companies going forward, because that too is in flux right now. So we have to, again, coming back to preparing people for those futures, making sure they're cognitively equipped for all of this, and understanding the big forces, the tectonic forces that are affecting the economic landscape. All of that is a very important part of what we have to prepare our young people for. Mm.
And maybe if you would want to comment on corruption, especially because that continues to, that's constantly, it's coming up, despite all the efforts the government has made.
I think that two things that need to be addressed, and as Jayant has rightfully said, that the term in itself is a blanket term used for many issues. So if you want to look at inequality and corruption together, what is it that has been done in the past 3 years? A very basic thing, that for a citizen sitting in a village, one of their biggest challenges was getting some money in terms of a subsidy or in terms of some kind of a dole or whatever encouragement that the government sought to give them, and to go to various levels of government and administration and try and get that. Mm-hmm. Most of the time, the very effort would cost more than the money that they were going to receive, so they would let it go. Now, this government, in the past 3 years, has opened and helped open around 30 crore bank accounts. Of which kind of citizens? Citizens who genuinely had no access to a structured, formal banking system, which is around 300 million people. That is catastrophic in terms of numbers of outreach that we have managed to bring formally into the banking system. Then the government said that, well, if we have to link we have to give them subsidy or we have to give them financial support, why not take it straight from the treasury and give it straight to the bank account? Imagine we saved over 50,000 crore rupees in that much. So when you talk about tackling corruption, at what all level are you talking about tackling corruption? It is a given that there has been absolutely no corruption charge about the government in the past 3 years. Mm-hmm. But how does it affect the common person? Today, the poorest of the poor know that if I need, let's say, a subsidy on two, three issues on which the government said it'll come straight from the treasury into my bank account, mm-hmm. then the first step, the government has enabled me opening a bank account. And the second step, I am seeing that leakages and those people in the middle who had access to my money now have no access because it's coming directly to mm-hmm. my bank account. Mm-hmm. The question that one has, I mean, in the 3 years that one has possibly not dwelled upon, mm-hmm. is that this is a humongous legacy of years and years of misgovernance that we are trying to correct now. That we have reached so far in the past 3 years, I'm not saying we're trying to pat ourselves on the back, but at least the numbers show the huge effort that has been made. That it has been done only in 3 years of governance. For instance, never in the history of our country did the Prime Minister stand at the ramparts of the Red Fort and said, let's build toilets for girls who go to school, because we see that they drop out after a certain level. And he set us a deadline of 1 year. And everybody said, this is not a deadline you can meet. Again, we leveraged technology. He spoke on the 15th of August. 17th of August, we had a website and an appeal to every citizen in the country. We said, the only way you can help us is walk into a government school right next to where you're living and tell us on our sheets, your district administration says it works. If it doesn't work, tell us. Mm-hmm. They told us, we corrected that information. And in 1 year, over 4 lakh toilets in government schools were built. And we have seen, we tracked those schools, and the enrollment of girls have gone up from 15%, even in areas like Shopian, up to 20%. That means change can happen. We are delivering within a particular amount of system. Now imagine, as I said in the beginning, that money is not the problem in education. The education problem is focused concentration and approach towards finding solution. If a government can help build in conjunction with states and various agencies, with the citizen watching, 4 lakh toilets in government schools, what all can we do when we all converge our efforts together? Mm-hmm. So when we talk about inequality as a woman, mm-hmm. Yes, the government can enable more and more women in boardrooms, mm-hmm. but it's the corporate structure that has to actually come forth and say how many and what kind of women do we want to encourage mm-hmm. in our corporate structures. If a government says, yes, I am willing to build toilets and other infrastructures for girls to study, it is for parents to decide. How many parents even know that in a government organization, a school management committee mm-hmm. has to comprise 75% of it is made up of parents, yeah. out of which 50% it's mandatory to have the mothers of the children in that SMC. Mm-hmm. So the Constitution gives us, the government gives us those rights. How many of us use it? Mm-hmm. That is the question that needs to be answered.
Building more toilets for women, Mr. Bhartia, could that be a part of the CSR obligations also for the private sector, which I think some are already doing?
Yes, that is part of it. And not only building toilets, but even supporting our, like wherever our factories are, we are supporting almost 100 schools in terms of how it can be managed better. So in terms of support, because the amazing part is the huge investment has been made by the government mm-hmm. on all the schools. It's just that a little bit last mile work needs to be done sometimes. Create a parent teachers association, as you rightly said. So the school starts functioning. And if there are gaps in terms of few teachers, we provide that. Mm-hmm. And I think most important thing is to use the government infrastructure that is hugely available mm-hmm. instead of creating new ones.
Right. Let's get the audience involved a bit now. So I hope there is a microphone that we can pass around the audience. Okay, so we'll do a quick quick poll inside the hall. All right, simple yes or no questions. So I'll tell you and then you raise your hand accordingly. Do you think our politics is aligned to the aspirations of the youth? So those who think it is, please, I urge all of you to participate. Please raise your hands. Yeah, that's 75%. No?
That's a relief.
And those of you who think it's not, those who didn't raise your hands, I'm guessing,
there
those who think it's not aligned.
Might not, right?
Okay, great. Could I have a microphone? Could one of you please? Yeah, exactly. Just hold on, sir. 1 second, sir. So could we again, those who think it is not aligned, politics is not aligned to the aspirations of the youth, could you please raise your hands once again? There were a lot many more raising their hands a short while ago, but never mind.
A cold call then, so they decided not to put their
okay.
hands up.
Yes. I would urge now one of you to sort of perhaps, yes, throw some light. Sir, you were raising your hand first. So, okay, yeah, just let him answer and then I'll come to you. You think it is not reflective of the aspiration of the youth. Please, and identify yourself as well.
My name is Amit Kasliwal. Till almost for 4,000 years, this country, Bharat, was full of entrepreneurs. You know, we were special weavers. Our marble used to be liked in Europe. It was just the period of 190 years of British rule that rogered, you know, everything in India. It rogered our confidence, it rogered our skill,
yeah.
The, all the export which used to happen. So this is the background which I'm coming from. All the IITs, all the business school, I'm also a pass, you know, I also passed out from a business school. When do we think about going back to our roots? You know, all of us come from small towns, we study in IIT, we study in business schools. Why just we look up to Walmarts and Unilevers for jobs? Why can't we take responsibility of our own villages, our own towns, and go back, and so on and so forth?
But why do you think
my sense is, you know, why we have to look outwards? We have to look inwards. We have everything. We have ancient textbooks.
Yes, but sir, why do you think the government is not? I'm sorry to put you. I mean, just since you raised your hand, hence I'm asking. Why do you think the government is not sort of representing the aspirations? Is there one specific example that you may want to give? And I'll throw it open to the others as well then.
Government, you know, we should look at how we can give real value to our weavers. You know, she was talking about, you know, weaver community. And he is not feeling confident.
Okay.
Does he want to continue? How do we create ecosystem
where
cottage industries, where a local entrepreneurship is encouraged?
All right, sir. Thank you. I'll just give a very short response.
I think one of the biggest challenges in terms of governance has been that, let's say, textiles, which encompasses close to 4-5 crore people, weavers, artisans, and everybody, plus their dependents. For the past... when we came into office, before that, at least 5 years, we have seen that out of the 40 schemes, 22 schemes were surrendered without spending a single rupee, which means that in a sector which impacts the largest amount of employment opportunities, more than 50% of the schemes never saw the light of day, which means you have 5 years of gap, not only of applying ourselves, but the negative impact of it another 1 or 2 years. So that is a 7-year impact which we have to now kind of turn around and bring some kind of a positive change. Very small thing. What does a weaver need? Today a weaver needs access to some financial support through a bank, and no weaver had any collateral to give. So the Mudra Yojana that was started by the Honorable Prime Minister, we tweaked it specially for weavers. We said that if you like Mudra Yojana, you can't go to a bank, we'll get the bank to you. And after ensuring that the weaver gets the bank support through Mudra Yojana, we did an impact analysis by a third party, nothing to do with government. And we said, tell us how much, if any, income generation has been you know, positively seen in these families. We saw that the incomes, especially those who are already working, went up to 60%. So these are the interventions now in the next, from 7th to 17th October, we are actually going down, there are 800 established clusters in the country. We are covering 401 of them in the next 10 days, just taking 15 nationalized banks to all these weaving communities and saying, start a relationship with your bank, they'll give you the loan, you are paying back. And the beauty of this country is the poorer the person, the better they are in terms of their financial responsibilities towards the bank. We've had 99% of people, weavers and artisans, return the money to the banking establishment, which is a big plus, because banks say, your guys, we give them the money, they at least have the decency to return it within a particular defined time structure. Apart from that, 2009-2010, there was a census done. Imagine a big population not having education. Only 1% of weaving artisan community had access to higher education. So through NIOS, which is the open school, and the open university, IGNO, we have asked weavers, why can't you teach your children? They said, 500 rupees bhi fees dene ka nahi hai hamare paas. So the government has decided that 75% of the fee reimbursement will happen by the government if a weaver and their kids enroll themselves for open school and open university. So many such things. But let it be said at least that we are seized of the challenges that they're facing.
I think you might have just convinced him by the look on his face. So very briefly identify yourself so that we can...
to tell people what
we're
doing. Yes.
Please be brief.
Yeah. My name is Nalin Savara. I'm an entrepreneur and a blogger. And I'm also a part of a think tank which Utkarsh Amitabh runs. And my point is that firstly, I want to compliment the government and the current establishment for everything you people are doing. Like, I remember there were things which were made a joke out of, that Narendra Modi comes on Teacher's Day and or Children's Day. And I really enjoyed it. I showed the video of Ms. Irani introduced Modi to my uncle in USA when I was there. And he was totally thrilled by it. So I think that is great. And not just us elites, but everybody sees it. But I think one place where the government is lacking, and it's severely lacking, is perceptions and perception management. In the sense that recently I was reading about a situation where they are planning to ban tobacco sellers from selling anything else, which means that all the grassroots pan shops will get destroyed. Now, it's one thing to know it as a fact, but it's another thing that the kind of impact it has on the ground, that everybody is talking of it, and everybody is talking of how much money the government has eaten and how corrupt the government is, that they are totally sold. So I once went to a barber shop in a Muslim-dominated area, and the conversation that was happening is something that if I repeat it, it'll seem as if somebody has paid me to speak. But the point I'm trying to make is that in spite of all the good you are doing, you need to be much more connected to the ground and the grassroots. There's a lot of things are well-intentioned, positively disruptive, but many times they can be really spun around as being campaigns to crush the Dalit or the minority right. or the man on the ground. And sometimes there are consequences. In the past, governments could afford to be less aware of the consequences. But I think in today's world, you need to be 100 times more aware, because things like tobacco ban is a moral thing. It's like a moral crusade. But the laborer who smokes 4 BDs, who am I to tell him that don't do it and end your day 4 hours earlier when he might be unemployed for the next 10 days and he wants to get as much money as he can so that he can buy atta and make rotis for his children. Right. So I think perception management is something which you people have to really...
Point well taken. Yes. I think you're absolutely on the dot in terms of perception management and rumor mongering. And I think that what is... And I would request you the next time you are in such a mohalla, irrespective of the mohalla you're in, one of the most fascinating aspects of Mudra Yojana has been, we always presumed, and as Jayant had said, that sab padhe likhe log sirf shahar mein hai, bade gharon mein hai. Now in Mudra Yojana, 70% of the beneficiaries are women. So imagine in India, where the highest amount of the world's illiterate adult population exists, you have women going up to a bank, giving them their own business plan, convincing the manager that this business plan works for me if you give me the money, actually getting that loan from the bank and utilizing it and paying back. Imagine that huge kind of a social, apart from the economic revolution that is happening in our country. And out of the beneficiaries, the finance ministry has actually told us, and Jayant would be better at explaining that, 55% of the beneficiaries actually are from the marginalized communities, SC, STs, OBCs. That means there is a lot more. I mean, I'm grateful that you acknowledge that there is a lot that we are doing, but in terms of perception, messaging, we can strengthen possibly. But at least I take heart in the fact that as a woman, 70% of the beneficiaries in the banking system for Mudra, loan without collateral, is women. That shows the potential, truly entrepreneurial potential of Indian women.
Now, Smriti ji, of course, is the Minister for Information and Broadcasting. So you ask the right question to the right person. But in fact, I'll say something else, which is that generally, if you read the media, we are accused of too much perception management. So the very fact that you're saying that we are not doing it tells me that we are kind of in the right spot. Some people are saying one thing, and other people are saying quite the opposite. So I think we
just, yeah.
See, I think your perception management is wrongly targeted. Like, I was once targeted on Twitter by a specific BJP troll who's followed by the Prime Minister, and he logged in as 6 different accounts to abuse me using the worst of words. And I think, okay. I really think that the loose cannons are
perceived as the government.
Having been, both Smriti ji and I have been the subject of much troll attacks. So
in
we
fact,
are very
I've had some people being very mehrban from the Gandhi family. So don't worry, right. You're not alone.
So that is something we have to live with in this age of social media.
Right,
hold on. So I think, of course, we obviously are familiar with that, and I think we are kind of where we should be with respect to dealing with communication to the public at large. But I want to correct one misimpression that you've been advocating, which is that we are cut off from the unfiltered opinions of the people of India. That is entirely untrue. Smriti ji, of course, and I as well, we tour the country extensively, and much more than that, as people who are representing the general public, I as a Lok Sabha member and so on. Every day I meet, when I'm in my constituency, thousands of people. thousands of people. And let me tell you, just like you are completely liberated in how you want to express yourself, shall we say, they're equally liberated and they're equally forthright in their opinion. So there is no filtering that's happening. We are not closeted away in some bubble where we are not listening to what people are saying. Mm-hmm. We, through social media and through our own personal encounters every day, are speaking to thousands and thousands of people, and so that does give us a feel for the pulse of the country.
No, and the fact that you're speaking in front of a, and you could speak to him directly on it, I think speaks a lot about the fact that what Jayant is saying, we're not closeted somewhere, we are engaging. I think it helps us as much as it helps you tell us your point of view, but as politicians, it helps
us
a lot.
But talking about trolling, I'm actually being trolled on Twitter right now. I'm being told, why am I not asking about jobs and employment and employability? So, let me throw it open to all my panelists, and perhaps if the ministers could take this question first, maybe I could start with you again.
I think we should ask the job creators.
Of course, the private sector has, will have to answer
for
that.
They are the real heroes. We are just here to support
them. But where are the jobs, Mr. Sinha? We should ask the job creators.
Let's ask our job creators here.
I think Jayant, you're leaving it open
to more trolling for yourself and for him.
I'm happy to get started if you want.
Okay, Anuj. So, I just want to throw up, like, recently Economic and Political Weekly came out with a study, that's one of their cover stories this time, where they've said that in terms of absolute numbers, there's actually been a decline in employment in the last three and a half years. But the period in question is from FY 2014 and FY 16. And the study concludes this is possibly the first time it's happened since independence. And I want to understand, because the government is, sort of putting the structures in place, the systems in place, why is it not translating into more jobs? So, Anu, I
think one of the things we've seen in the last few years has been a rise of the startups in the country, right? So we've seen a lot of venture capital going into startups and all of that. Now, while startups can generate a certain amount of jobs, and I think they are already doing that, and I think that's increasing by the day, I think what is really important is to be able to build the ecosystem between the larger companies and the startups. And I think once we get that and we get the right thing in place where we can say that you build these innovative companies, and then those technologies are being then acquired by companies within India, then I think we are likely to see a bigger use of those technologies, for instance. So, for instance, I'm giving an example. Let's say if I'm in the genomic space, there are lots of companies developing certain kinds of diagnostics today, right? Little amount of money goes into them. But in order to make it scalable, in order to make it work, you need to have access to a very large group of people who can actually go and distribute that. So I think, one, the reality is that innovations will be developed by a smaller group of, startups, which are going to be able to create that. But in order to really see a scale effect of that, I think unless our own ecosystem is developed well enough where the larger companies find value in that, I think we will not see, one is that reality. The second, I think, is that we are, what has happened today is that a lot of people are getting their first jobs, becoming a delivery boy or something else. How do we get them to actually start moving up the value chain, right? So we got the call center happened, a lot of people started getting into that about 10 years ago, and that sort of created a lot of jobs for the industry. Today, have we been able to recreate that for those call center employees and be able to give them something that can then create another set for other people to go in? So I think one is to be able to create the right sort of a value chain for these people so that they can continue to go up, but at the same time creating that for the other people. The third was that I think today I was in a discussion on agriculture and nutrition, and one of the biggest challenges, and I think Mr. Bhartia also pointed out, that 50% of our population is the most unproductive today in terms of, if we take productivity per person. So if we want to actually change that, how do we actually make them technologically much more viable, right? So how do we get technologies like startups in agriculture or in engineering to be able to help these farmers become much more productive? How do we move those farmers from doing what they're doing today, some of them? So if from 50% want to go to 30%, how do we get that 20% to go into, let's say, ocean farming or something else, something more exciting that they can get into? And I think those will be the sort of things that we need to start thinking, because we can't just say that it is one person's responsibility or the other. We have to develop an ecosystem where each one feeds off the other. And I think that is where I look at
Can I add on to it?
Yeah, you know, because, ma'am, textiles today employs, what, 65 million odd people, or perhaps slightly more. And you unveiled a textile policy about a year ago, and one of the focal points of that policy was to create more jobs.
One of the perception things that the gentleman spoke about is absolutely ringing true today on stage. We did not announce a textile policy last year. We actually announced a 6,000 crore package only for the apparel sector and then added additional value for the made-up sector. And the issue on hand in terms of jobs, so 7 years, as I had said in one of my earlier answers, was a period where 50 to 55% of anything related to textiles in terms of governance was absolutely shut down. So the 40% or the 45% that persists is something which was only persisting because of industry effort. Mm-hmm. Now, in the past one and a half years in textiles, there are two, three things that I have seen which has happened because we've merged our forces with industry. India has never, ever leveraged its textile and handcraft strength ever under one roof. Most of our countrymen were going from one country to another, at least 120 destinations in the world, to take their wares and say, well, this is what we have to sell, and then be at the mercy of whoever's organizing that expo to find one little spot at the end of the expo and say, this is what I have made in India, and they would say, okay, fine. I would buy something if you sell it to me the cheapest. And we said, why not then say that if I have a good product, give me a good markup or a good price? That confidence to the industry comes, especially the small players, only when there is enough backing from the government. And the 6,000 crore package that we did, we saw that when the industry worldwide saw the government standing shoulder to shoulder with the local industry, we've had three times FDI in our investment into textiles, which is the first in the history of our country. Such a huge influx of funds only to ensure that the sector expands. But how do you create jobs? That is the question which with which you began. Now, when you look at textiles, is it only to a concentration on apparel? No, it is also a concentration on beginning from the grassroots for the textile, which is agriculture. We are one of the biggest cotton producing countries in the world. How do I create extra jobs in cotton? Let's say I have a hectare which is producing only 500 kilos, or the international mark is around 1,500. So I have to introduce either new technology or new hands to ensure that that aspect in terms of enhancing output from a particular set amount of land given is something that we engage in. How does that engagement happen? By setting up those little labs, rural labs, that helps that farmer to ensure that we have more output. Second aspect, when you're picking cotton, most of the Indian cotton, the problem is that they don't get as good a price as other international suppliers of cotton because we, in some way or the other, contaminate our cotton while picking. So where does the skill set come in? You have a very small instrument which actually just sucks the cotton out, which plucks the cotton without any manual intervention. So you need an additional trainer that will come per farm or a set of four or five farms. Plus you have that instrument which is possibly designed by, it comes around $3,000. So the company that makes that instrument, plus trainers who come in. Then once that cotton is totally plucked, you need to actually grade it. Nobody grades it. We pick up that cotton, we ship it out. Somebody grades it very well, long staple, short staple, and sends it back to us. So these are the efforts and these are the steps in which we create more and more job opportunities. When we get into textile in terms of apparel, we have a huge capacity right now in spinning. But in terms of apparel, what is the thing in India that we can leverage? We have a huge design capacity. We have a huge legacy when it comes to handcraft. Are we engaging more and more students into that design capacity? Let's say today if you want to go and buy a handicraft, how good is our packaging when it comes to that handicraft? Are we up to international standards? So currently, our exports are around 37,000 crores. But can we become better? Yes, because if you package your ware, if you see a Chinese drum, it is much better packaged. So you might feel that my tantura, that handheld little thing, is as exquisite, but we are not packaging it well. So where do we get that additional job? We get it when we try to inspire people. Why don't you get, you know, attached to a design school that the government pays for and learn new packaging concepts, and you have additionality in terms of job at that level. Mm-hmm. So from top down and from bottom up, mm-hmm. on the top level, we are giving subsidy. I mean, I'm sitting in an institute of technology, and I've repeatedly told the industry that the sunrise sector for technology is technical textiles that we call. Now, mm-hmm. technical textiles has a subsidy support of capital subsidy of 25%. Not mm-hmm. many takers. Why? Because apparel mein ji sabse achha dhanda hai. I say, but technical textiles means mm-hmm. that you have as much to contribute to ISRO as you would have to making a bridge or an airport. So why not look at that aspect? Mm-hmm. Why not go into supply of medical textiles? Mm-hmm. Why buy medical textiles and import it? Why don't you do it here? So slowly the industry is getting into that aspect that which textile is not only about clothes that you wear. Mm-hmm. We've had as much a contribution in the 104 satellites that ISRO let go in one day. Mm-hmm. The carbon tax is the future. I mean, IIT Delhi has a textile little component somewhere. And Dr. Rao and I are speaking as to how to bring that together. Mm-hmm. So when we look at a sector, there are many layers to that sector that we have to discuss. And those are the layers where the jobs are embedded.
And tapping the untapped potential, yes. Precisely what you're saying. Mr. Bhartia, all eyes on you. You're the sole representative of the private sector on the panel.
No, I...
But jobs...
What I want to emphasize is, if you really see globally, in most parts of the world, the real jobs, the most job creators are micro, small, and medium enterprises. Large enterprises don't create that scale of job, and it cannot be done. So, and how do you, and what are micro enterprises? They are actually family enterprises. Mm-hmm. So these are entrepreneurship, which happens in every parts of the country. Now, how do you create that ecosystem of entrepreneurship? What you need is partly risk capital, how banks fund it, what's the interest rate? We talked about interest rate today. India is mm-hmm. one of the highest interest rate regime right now. Mm-hmm. So if you want to compete with Chinese, it's tough. It's mm-hmm. tough because the kind of interest rate a small entrepreneur pays mm-hmm. is today as high as 15%. How does he compete? So and how do you remove the inspector Raj? How do you remove controls there? Mm-hmm. Especially at the lower level. Mm-hmm. When you are a large organization, you have an infrastructure to deal with all kinds of regulation. But when you are a micro enterprise, a startup, and I'm not talking about high technology startup, I'm talking about small entrepreneurship mm-hmm. of any kind, services. Today you can start services, and that's how self-employment begins. Mm-hmm. So I think the real job creators will be the micro. Starting is micro enterprise, which becomes smaller and then medium and then to large. So that unless you feed in mm-hmm. from the bottom, you will not have job creation. So what you have to see is, if a small guy who has to create an enterprise, what are his hindrances? Mm-hmm. And that's where the challenges are, the local inspector Raj, the constraints that he has. And, you know, the corruption from top has going down. There's no corruption at the top, you know. But slowly, it has to percolate down to the lowest level and say that there is no corruption. Mm-hmm. And I think that will help a lot. That will help a lot in terms of how you make it easier. Like we're talking about Prime Minister's biggest dream is how to make it easy to do business. Mm-hmm. And I think that is most relevant for a smaller enterprise. You know, large enterprises have a plethora of people to deal with regulation. Mm-hmm. They can deal with it. Let's not worry about them. Mm-hmm. But let's worry about the real small enterprises where entrepreneurship begins. And the last point I want to make is, mm-hmm. in India, we have a fear of failure, you know. A guy who fails, we just shoot him down. In America, that's why, there's one reason America is successful is, if you are a three-time failure as a startup, you have a great respect because they say you have experience. The fourth time, you will be successful. In India, mm-hmm. banks will kill you. If you second time you come after failing, second time they say, you will never ever give you money. You put your wife's jewelry, your home, your mm-hmm. everything. Mm. Now, how does he start an enterprise? Mm-hmm. I think that's a big challenge. So we must... Failing is part of natural process. In our body, cells fail and rejuvenate. Mm-hmm. So we need to allow failure to happen. Mm-hmm. Because that's where rejuvenation will take place.
Utkarsh, what about you? Because you've been working on sort of changing, molding the education system that you've been talking about. What has been the experience, you know, products of that, of this new system that you're trying to create, and their employability opportunities?
Sure.
India is at the beginning of what they call the fourth industrial revolution. If you go back and look at other industrial revolutions, first, second, and third, no industrial revolution has led to a net loss of jobs. One of the biggest fears that we have today is that the fourth industrial revolution will lead to short-term loss of jobs. And I believe that if you go on and look at research done, and in my practical example, which I'll refer to right now, is that each job which will be replaced in the short term will lead to five new jobs, but in different industries, cybersecurity, the gig economy. And I think that's what we need our workforce to prepare in. So we need to do three concrete things, in my opinion. First is we need to focus also on the village mm-hmm. in India. 70% of India is today in the villages. Mm-hmm. I've been a part of the team that's built India's first smart village in Harisal, which is now featured in the Prime Minister's Book of Innovation. Mm-hmm. When we started work, it was infamously referred to as the epicenter of malnutrition. Today, if you go to Harisal and you look at, there's internet, people use payment apps to transact with each other. There is prevalence of e-commerce, telemedicine. There is digital classrooms. There are skilling centers. And what I notice is that if technology is an enabler rather than an imposition, coupled with the aspirations of the village, we really can catapult India, and India can embrace the fourth industrial revolution equitably and sustainably. Second, there is something called flipped classroom. Right, where a teacher comes in, not necessarily to do the traditional role of mm-hmm. teaching and going back. So mm-hmm. I would like to suggest that parts of what the current government is doing very well is what you call flipped governance, mm-hmm. wherein the government makes specific interventions and plays the role of an unblocker. So instead of the role of my Baap Sarkar, I think the government 3.0 that Jayant Sinha ji talked about and Smriti ji talked about as well, is that government really identifies and has a bottoms-up approach and looks at what are the key pain points that people are facing, institutions are facing, and unblocks them. And the third and final point is, and you referred to that in the Harvard study, Ronanjay, we need also a diversity in the parliament. If you look at the average age of India today and the average age of the parliament in India today, there is a huge difference. Mm-hmm. So you need to create a context where young people, inspired people, have the ability to be civic entrepreneurs, political entrepreneurs, and what have you. And then you'll see this cognitive diversity, the diversity of age, religion, region, gender, and all reflect that. Women today contribute just less than 25% of GDP in India. Imagine the potential we'd unleash if we're able to leveraging these 3 points of focusing on rural, flipped governance, and diversity of all kind. I think that will be the India ready for the fourth industrial revolution. That will be the India that you need for jobs of the future. And that's the India that I personally am excited to live in 2022.
Mm-hmm. Fine points there, Utkarsh. Mr. Sinha, if I could bring you back into this conversation, talking about jobs, Mr. Bhartia talked about how India has a very high, Indian companies pay a lot of interest on their loans. Today, the Reserve Bank met and they've kept their repo rates unchanged. If I could request you to don once again your hat of the Minister of State for Finance, is that a bit of a disappointment from the government's perspective? Because, yesterday the announcement came for a 2 rupee cut in excise duty on petrol. So one thought that will give some room to the Monetary Policy Committee to deliberate over a possible rate cut. That has not happened.
Sure, happy to comment on that. But before that, let me say something to what Utkarsh was saying. Utkarsh, I know age is on your side. But I think Hari and I will tell you that youth is simply a state of mind. Yes. So we can think young. We can think, even though we may not look young, we can think young.
Absolute diversity.
And that is what entrepreneurship is all about, which is you have to think different. You have to think new ideas, you have to think innovations. And I think that's really what is key for us in this economy going forward. And coming back to your jobs, and then I will get back to the rate issue, which is that, right now we are going through a paradigm shift in the economy, which is what I spoke about earlier also. We're going through a fundamental structural transformation of the economy, and that's why the jobs numbers, which are sort of the traditional way in which we've been measuring jobs, are really not a good way to understand the jobs of the future and what the economy is doing to create employment. As Anu was saying, we have a lot of entrepreneurship happening now. That's not being picked up in the numbers. We have a lot of micro-entrepreneurship happening, as Smriti Ji was saying, through Mudra, where over 8 crore people have got Mudra loans. That's not being picked up right now. As far as the organized sector is concerned, that perhaps is not growing as quickly as it has. But again, in some ways, people are looking at the wrong places. Every time a new economic cycle starts, it's not the old industries that really power it, it's the new industries. So don't look at IT services and BPO. That industry is maturing. Look at aviation, for example, or look at what's happening in renewable energies or in medical technology. That's where the new growth is going to come from. Those are going to be the new industries. And the kinds of jobs they're going to create in e-commerce or in aviation are going to be very different from the kinds of jobs we have in the past. That's the paradigm shift that's happening. Mm-hmm. And we still don't have a very good way, and I speak as a scientist, we don't have a very good way, we have no instrumentation yet to really be able to pick that up and understand how that is happening. But I think anecdotally and intuitively we can sense that we have to do a better job as government and of course independent agencies in really instrumenting it and picking that up. So that is as far as job creation is concerned. I'm very hopeful because I think the key drivers are in place, whether it's entrepreneurship, whether it's cost competitiveness, formalization of the economy, financing in many different ways. All those things are in place now. We have a young, vibrant, talented population. So I think we will have the entrepreneurial explosion that we need. So that's as far as jobs are concerned. Now coming to rates.
Yes, please.
Away from the long term to the short term. Now, obviously, as you know, that is the prerogative of the RBI. I think as far as government is concerned, we've had a very consistent position for some time now that we think as far as real interest rates are concerned, they should certainly be competitive. And exactly as Hari was saying, if we have to compete with the rest of the world, if our small businesses have to compete with China and other very formidable competitors, our inputs have to be appropriately priced. And if you look at capital, particularly debt capital is a very important input. Is it priced at the rate which will make us competitive? And that's where we have expressed our concerns. And I think even if you look empirically at the data would suggest that real interest rates should be much lower as far as India is concerned. But all that being said, this is really the prerogative of the Reserve Bank of India. They are the ones who are professionally tasked. They are responsible for this policy, and so we have to leave them into their wisdom and to their judgment as far as monetary policy is concerned.
Ms. Irani, if you could
comment
on that.
He's donned that hat very elegantly.
Thank you, Smriti.
My compliments as
you know, especially at a time when the government is also trying to revitalize the economy. I think the MPC would have a more sympathetic year, so to speak, but that is not the case.
It's status quo. So the government is sympathetic. Let me give you the government's point of view, and Jayant is he's been erudite in what the RBI is doing. How do I protect, let's say, my sector? Mm-hmm. So, and I say my sector, my weavers, because I find myself very much ingrained now with the community. One of the biggest challenges for weavers was that I don't have money to buy new implements because they're very costly, and I won't get easy access to finance with very high interest rates. What do I do? We put them through a whole training process, mm-hmm. where you give them the soft skills, the packaging skills. And once they've gone through that training process, we say, you pick a machine of your choice, you pick a loom of your choice. 90% of the money is now given by Government of India, which means after we pay for it, you get it home, you use it, you tell me this is functioning properly, then you pay 10% of it only into your bank account. That is how I protect, let's say in my ministry, the weaving community. Similarly, the artisan community. What is it that they need, let's say, to have more productivity? They will say, I'll need tools. Which are the ones which are the most financially challenged? Those in the minority community, marginalized community, Divyangjan, women, BPL families, we give them toolkits free of cost. That is how I protect that one segment which is under my responsibility. So while the RBI does what it does best, and Jayant is the best person to comment on it, at least as a government, we are sympathetic on these issues. Mm-hmm. And given everybody's responsibility, we make sure that at least in our core sectors, we try and protect those who are going to be most hard hit by it. So even in the Mudra scheme, there is an intervention which is done predominantly by the textile ministry. We also join forces, let's say, with the minority affairs ministry. Mm-hmm. We have a lot of weavers from the minority community. They also give them that protection from heavy interest so that we absorb it as government. Ultimately, I think from what Utkarsh said about flipped governance, that is something which we already in part doing. The Prime Minister himself on infrastructural challenges and projects takes a meeting called Pragati, where through video conference he's connected to every state in the country and long pending issues are brought to his table, and every state then in conjunction with the central government talks about what is the progress, let's say, in building a national highway or building infrastructure of national importance, what is the stage they are at, if there are any challenges with regards to paperwork, how can they be solved, mm-hmm. And the decisions are taken then and there, and Pragati mm-hmm. is something which the Prime Minister himself hosts. So looking at the Prime Minister, for instance, I spoke about these 400 clusters in which we are reaching out. We've had a conversation with collectors of 288 districts. Mm. And we've specially spoken to them through video conference that this camp will be held in your district. Can you please ensure that you take an additional meeting with banks in your district so that the banks are present on that day? Mm-hmm. So that is the level to which, in terms of governance, our government is reaching out. Mm-hmm. And we are hopeful that with this kind of a continuous engagement at the grassroots with administration, with the people, we will rise up to the expectations mm-hmm. of the citizens.
Mr. Bhartia, if you could also comment, since you are the one who raised the issue of interest rates, since it's companies like you who have to pay for high interest rates, disappointed with what the RBI did today, before I throw it open to the audience.
Yeah, I'm a bit disappointed because, you know, I'm a businessman, I'm not an economist, but of course they have taken a thoughtful decision. But if you look at the real interest rate, if I look at inflation, and look at the real interest rate in India, is quite high because the inflation is in control. So at some level, easing is required, I believe. And for everyone, for consumers, because somebody is doing housing loan mm-hmm. or buying a car or buying household goods, mm-hmm. I think it impacts the overall economy and even especially the small sector, I do believe, because the impact is much more felt if you go down, because the differential keeps going up.
Could we have some questions then from the audience? Please be brief, because we are really running out of time. The lady over there at the back. Just one second, a microphone
will reach
you.
Hi, my name is Dhwani. I'm picking up this question from something that Mr. Sinha said, that the flux of industries is uncertain right now, where we will go, especially in terms of technology. And then there are two schools of thoughts around the world, wherein one school of thought supported by the likes of Stephen Hawking and Elon Musk say that developments in technology will actually take away the conventional jobs. Whereas there is another school of thought by the likes of Peter Thiel, who say that these will actually help. So my question is, how does the government plan to align the skill development according to the requirement when the future is so uncertain? Like, I don't know whether as a doctor I would be expected to do surgeries or assist my robo or help feed data to my robo to do surgeries. So how does the government...
I'll just partly answer that. And... because in this very institution, we started a program called Imprint, which was dedicated to the nation by the Prime Minister and the President when I was in HRD. Imprint, for the first time in the history of our country, all IIT directors, faculty members have gotten together, along with all technological institutions across the country. They've made a network. And we have top 10 topics that were chosen by the faculty members. They range from advanced science, material science onwards to healthcare, to habitat, many defense, many such purposes have been identified. Apart from a prediction in terms of what is the advancement that we foresee, for the first time, we've also complemented it with manpower planning. Because still now, at least little experience that I've had in administration, we found that manpower planning with regards to a particular sector was never a part of our agenda, at least in educational institutions. And hence, when you have a significant amount of resources which are concentrated on what kind of manpower and what kind of skill sets they will need to have, so let's say 15 or 10 years down the line or 5 years down the line, those are the parameters that we've already identified for the academicians in our country. And the academicians are working in tandem with the industry. So it's not only academic work. The industry is very much a part of that entire, because I think your director, Mr. Rao, is also a part of it. I think Manna in IIT Kanpur was housing it. So the fact that it goes from water resources to healthcare to housing to defense means the plethora of opportunities for us as a nation is covered under it. The manpower planning gives us an opportunity not only to understand, let's say, what skill sets you need in the future, but who are the specialists that you will need who will mentor you or handhold you, those also become a part of that study. So in terms of preparation for the future academically, that is what has already been initiated in the year 2015. We've already done that. And I think that out from that document then stems, because we have connected every ministry in the government to that exercise. So what Imprint does is, let's say we are predicting something in the petrochemical divisions in our country. So Imprint, the academicians, the industry, then in tandem with that particular ministry sits down and says, we need additional support for that particular segment. For instance, in open oil fields, we never had students go and do research. They were never permitted. So one of the first MOUs we had with the petroleum ministry is allowing our faculty members and our students to go out and, you know, operate and do research in oil fields, which, I mean, I was shocked it's never happened in our country, but we managed to do that through Imprint. So many such things, including affordable housing and other technologies, not only normal day-to-day, but advanced sciences also is something that we have kind of worked on under Imprint.
Mm-hmm. So let me quickly add to that. Do we as government know what skills are required 10 or 20 years from now? Absolutely not. And I don't think anybody knows. Because the world is evolving very quickly, but as Smriti ji has comprehensively and brilliantly articulated, we've put in place the system with the appropriate feedback so the system can keep evolving as we go along. The necessary stakeholders are part of the system. They are going to be continuously refining and thinking whether it is the scientific areas of inquiry or whether it is the actual HR, the human capital that is required to support that. That system will start evolving by itself and figuring out in a bottoms-up grassroots way what is actually required for the future. And that really is the role of government, because we can't solve every single problem. What we have to do is empower and facilitate and enable all of you as citizens, as business people, as scientists, as entrepreneurs, to go out and solve all the problems that we see. So ours is really a role of enablement and facilitation to be able to remove the bottlenecks, to expedite what we can, but it is really up to you to figure that out.
Well, absolutely. In a VUCA world, they say volatile, uncertain, chaotic, and ambiguous. It's hard for anybody to predict what the future will be like. Maybe the guy at the back in the red T-shirt, if we could have a microphone passed to him, please.
This gentleman, yes.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jagopal. I'm a student of 12th standard. And my important question is, as I will be the future job seeker of the country or the job provider of the country. So one day I was watching a TED of Mr. Ernesto Ciroli, and he said he read something in the Futurist magazine that in the 18th or 19th century, there was a discussion of economists and the most influential people of New York that what will drove the city of New York in the 20th century. And the panel said the city of New York will not be sustained till then, because till that time you will be needing 6 million horses. I mean, what they wanted to say that we are not having sustainability in our future right now, as the IT sector is getting saturation. And the leadership which has to be worked upon, it is not, what I have to say that the government isn't working upon the leadership part of the country. I mean, they're not engaging leadership among the youth.
Right.
So I think that, main himakat karti hun aapke uspe bolne ki. Bahut important cheez hai what you have said, that a gentleman that you saw on TED read something. And that is where the whole fulcrum of the whole issue is. That if you read how India is leading on issues of sustainable development, you'll be extremely proud of the achievement of your country. That what we have done in, you know, on the international stage in terms of taking responsibility and having a leadership role, especially when those so-called superpowers left the field, I think that is something that every Indian can be proud of. But I also feel that the future of business is a business which is focused on sustainability. So when we are talking, let's say, again, I'll come back to my prime love, which is handloom. Mm-hmm. The Prime Minister launched something called the India Handloom Brand. And the reason for starting that handloom brand was because when internationally we had people, or even for that matter, Indian retail giants wanting to take up, let's say, a handloom product, we asked them, what is the biggest thing that negates your desire to pick up something handloom? They said the color bleeds. And why the color bleeds is because they said that you're using all these kind of chemicals and dyes, and we have now a consumer base which is very conscientious. How do we protect, or how do we engage better with them? Now, under the India Handloom brand, we had a special segment only for registration of organic dyes and colors, especially by people who belong to little, you know, these clusters or these villages where traditionally that natural dyes were made. We have 60 such now registered colors and dyes. And the fact that today, because of that one brand initiative, which we used the Prime Minister as the brand ambassador, we had a Pochampalli cluster in Andhra. We had somebody, have you heard of the brand Biba?
Yeah.
So we told Biba, we said, why don't you pick up the cloth directly from the weaver? Don't have a middle person, don't even have government, nobody. Biba picked up 2.5 lakh meters of cloth from them. And they made the last, you know, festive season clothes out of it. So like Jayant says, that our job is to facilitate that communication between parts of the community, and then how the community takes it forward is something that is dependent on certain individuals. But on the issues of sustainable development and respect for natural resources, I think you as an Indian, especially as a young Indian, should be very proud of the stand that our country has taken on that issue of, you know, ecology complementing economy.
The red flag has been waved, and we really need to wrap up this this panel discussion. But before we go, I want to ask, maybe I'll start with the ministers, then Mr. Bhartia, and each one of you.
Start with Mr. Bhartia, then Utkarsh, and then come to the ministers last.
Exactly.
So, Mr. Bhartia, then tell me what, I mean, you know, as a leading industrialist, when you look at the future, what is that one problem that possibly keeps you awake at night?
Is really jobs. And I do worry about jobs, because we have a very large number of people coming into the job market, especially, we have a double pressure. Population is one, and the efficiency of agriculture, which I mentioned earlier, because that 70% or 50% of the people who are employed in agriculture, it's not possible, it's not sustainable. So how do we absorb them, and how do we create jobs? Mm-hmm. To me, creating jobs is the biggest challenge that I see. Mm-hmm. And we all have to work together.
Mm-hmm.
Industry, government, social...
Cannot sector. Be left to one agency.
That's one thing that I worry about.
Mm. Anu?
So for me, I think the biggest, and I think both the young doctor and the 12th standard person, both of y'all raised interesting questions. I think that the future, we have to do a what-if analysis and start thinking, how do we get everyone to start thinking? And I think if we can get our youth to start thinking, if we can get our people who are already at a certain age to start thinking about what they can, how they can tackle a problem, how they can read more, how they can do all of that, right, from the beginning to the end, I think we would be able to solve any problem that comes our way. So whether, you know, you will be assisting the robot or the robot will be assisting you, I think is only a question of your mind, right? And similarly, I think there are going to be tectonic changes, and there will be that. I think that's a given. And one must always constantly think that, can I not become a slave to technology, but let technology be this thing. So I think for y'all, there are a lot of more fundamental questions than we had when we were at your age. But the good thing is that you have access to so much information and content that allows you, whether it's TED, whether it's any other thing. But please, I hope that the country reads more.
Utkarsh?
you know, through network capital and through my other initiative, through the shape, through, I realized that ikigai is what I'd like to leave everyone with. There's this Japanese term which is at the intersection of who you are, what you're good at, what the world needs, and what you can be paid for. So this sweet spot is my, you know, my inspiration or for India of 2022. Who you are is something that the Indian philosophy essentially encourages us to do. From we are born, we are a reflective breed. What we are good at is something that the Atal Innovation Mission and others are trying to create. Like from a nation of told what to do, to a nation that questions, to a nation that innovates. What the world needs is sustainable development. And if you look at India's ranking in sustainable development goals, although Smriti very rightly pointed out, we've done a lot of work to make that ranking go up, but even today we are 116th out of 157. So we still have, for 2022, a very long way to go. But thanks to the current efforts, we are in the right direction. And what you can be paid for is essentially the future of skills, which was pointed out. The future of skills is everyone knows that the absolute bottom of the pyramid and absolute top, it's very hard to automate. It's the middle that is at the immediate threat of automation. So we need to inspire reskilling and continual learning through our educational systems and informal systems and peer learning mechanisms to inspire ikigai amongst the youth and amongst everyone.
Mr. Chansana?
There are, of course, many areas for us to work on, and I don't have a complicated concept like the one Utkarsh just gave from Japan. I just have a very simple word, which is education. That's the one thing we need to work on. Because I think if we can educate our people well, train them to be well-equipped for the future, to have the cognitive capacity, the ability to contextually understand the world and the big forces that are shaping our future, then, in fact, we will have the innovation, we'll create the jobs, and we'll have a better future for all of us. So for me, the one word is education.
Final word.
For me, it is connecting the dots, actually. I think the fact that when Hariji speaks about job and he talks about the efficacy of agricultural production today, we all know that only 5 to 6% of our fruit produce gets processed. Now, that is a huge capacity in terms of job generation, in terms of investment. It may happen at a larger scale, but it'll be more effective if it happens at the smaller scale. The government has provided those kind of mechanisms, be it through loans, be it through other initiatives like Startup and Stand Up. The idea is just to connect those dots. And when I say connect the dots, it envelops everything that either Utkarsh or Mr. Sinha or Anu is saying. I think the idea is you cannot say that only this one particular compartment or this one particular silo is where the entire solution rests. Mm-hmm. I think in a country which is as diverse as ours, which is has so many aspirations, people speaking so many dialects and languages, the idea is to connect the dots, be it at the governance level, be it at the citizens level, be it the community level. Can we afford to let this time go by us? We can't. And that is why I said it's imperative that we all work together. Mm-hmm. Elections are fought from one 5 year to another 5 year. But in between that, it is a time for the people to say that this is my government, which is the outreach that the Prime Minister is doing. One of the biggest successes is the Swachhata Abhiyan. And that is not a vote bank. That is actually something that you feel for your own country, your own community, and you help try to keep your own place clean, free of dirt or free of somebody trying to spit at a wall which is freshly painted. That is a mindset. Mm-hmm. So it has to be connecting the dots, owning up that this is my country, and there are certain things government can help fix, but there are certain things we take along with the government. Mm-hmm. Swachhata Abhiyan is one such aspect. It is not only about formally teaching people to use a toilet. It's also about creating that mindset that this is not a toilet, this is actually an izzat ghar. That when you use it, you help give that kind of respect to the women in the family. You help give respect to the fact that there are health challenges which you will face if you do not use these kind of, you know, instruments which the society wants you to use. So I think it's ultimately education. It's ultimately also having to upskill ourselves, not only from the hard skills, but also the soft skills that we need, but also to register that there are gaps which can be filled with government intervention, but with equal support from citizens at large.
So a whole lot of work to be done, but directionally, we are on the right track. Thank you very much to all my panelists for taking out time and actually interacting with all of us, and a big thank you as well to the audience.
Thank you, Ron. Thank you.
behalf of the World Economic Forum, CNBC TV 18, thank you once again for joining us. Please tweet to us what you thought and give us your comments, and we'll make sure that all the panelists, those comments, reach them. Thank you very much once again.